are there substances that people are ingesting on a regular basis that would tend to counteract the natural ingestion of the DMT to be counteractive to it?
Well, in our studies, I was pre-treating people just a few hours before the injection of DMT to determine if we could block the effects, or I guess even more accurately is, you know, to blunt the effects. And we briefly studied a narcotic blocking drug. It's called naltrexone. it made people pretty uncomfortable just all by itself.
Mm-hmm.
And it was hard to get the volunteers to get into that study. We also were treating people with a specific antihistamine, which also is a blockader of serotonin. And the volunteers really got sleepy and dopey on that drug. It was hard, you know, to get those people, you know, to take that drug as well. You know, so we were kind of starting those studies, but they were hard to tease apart what were the effects of the medication alone versus what were its effects on blocking DMT. Also, it was hard to recruit volunteers for those studies. Nobody was that keen on getting in a DMT study that kind of reduced the effects. So it was around that time that the studies became not quite as much fun to do. People were not quite as enthusiastic about volunteering.
Mm-hmm.
Adverse effects started to just seem a little clearer to me, and also I wasn't really getting that impressed with any long-term benefits from people's big experiences on DMT. So there were a number of factors that kind of got me to start slowing down the research and ultimately stop doing it around the end of 1995 or so.
They, some of the spiritual traditions say that one's intent going into a meditation, a prayer, a ceremony, whatever, is the key. And I have found, too, that say a prayer before you're meditating. I have a much better meditation, a much more mystical one. Did anybody add some of those elements? I intend to, you know, commune with our Creator as opposed to an alien. Did people able to direct the nature of their experience at all through their intent or?
Well, for the first few minutes, it was really quite impossible to direct anything. All one could do was hold on. But a lot of people kind of went into it, either chanting or praying or meditating.
Mm-hmm.
And then once they started coming out of it, they would then continue with the chanting or hand movements, breathing, that sort of stuff. But everybody went into it with an intent to become a healthier person, to encounter a source of love and of wisdom and of healing. But like we were talking about in the first half of the interview, the most important thing wasn't even as much intent as really being able to relax into the onset of effects. If anybody had any resistance or any fear, really tried to hold on or resist, they really had a hard time.
But you end up on an operating table with aliens and androids standing over you. That could be a little intimidating.
It really blew people's minds. It really blew mine, too. I mean, I would hear these stories. I'd say, oh, shit, what's that? You know, so, yeah, so I took notes and said, well, I've been hearing more and more stories like that. But I just kind of, you know, tucked them away for future reference. It was hard to come up with an explanatory model, either to me or the volunteers. Like I would say, it's your brain on drugs. And they'd say, well, no, it didn't feel that way. There couldn't be a center in the brain that mediates alien contact. I'd say, yeah, probably not.
Well, two questions on that. One is, how real was it to the person experiencing it? Was it like, you know, viewing something distorted, or was it very physically real to them?
Oh, it was absolutely real, undeniably real, a lot more than dreams, a lot more than everyday reality. They would say that was more of a real experience than everyday reality.
Oh, one of those.
It was absolutely compelling.
Wow.
Yeah.
The other question is, wasn't there some open brain studies in which somebody took some instrument and stimulated parts of the brain, and there was one little part where consistently a number of people had encounters with little blue alien beings or something? I read that somewhere.
Yeah, well, I think you may be talking about this, fellow up in Canada whose name, his name is Persinger.
Persinger, okay.
And he's got a helmet that he puts on people, which kind of stimulates brain. Well,
he wasn't doing open brain. That was another study. But
no,
there was something similar that would stimulate a certain section was finding that kind of response. So, go ahead.
Well, yeah, I'm not sure. I'm trying to think. Because there clearly are studies where people are undergoing open brain surgery, and they do have little bits of their brain stimulated for experimental purposes.
I've read it both places, I think. So.
Yeah, but in terms of more contemporary research that I'm familiar with, this Persinger fellow in Canada is doing work where he places a special kind of helmet on people, and it can induce a feeling of there being someone else in the room, not to have the experience, but anywhere close to the kind of detail and intensity of reality that our volunteers described, those studies aren't anywhere close to the kinds of reports that we found.
When people went back consistently and interacted with these aliens, the stories that came up, were they similar in terms of the intent of the aliens? Why were they doing this? What was their quest, their lack of emotions? It seems all similar to the abduction literature out there.
Well, it kind of does, doesn't it? A couple of people reported that these beings were interested in our future and were kind of describing or were portraying our future to us. Also, there was sort of some kind of reciprocity between us and them in terms of their intelligence and advanced technology in exchange for the emotional information that we possessed. So that also kind of dovetails with some of the spontaneous reports of abductees.
Hmm.
Some people were reporting being kind of tested. Certain parts of their bodies were being tested. Others described an experience of being reprogrammed or things being kind of implanted in consciousness that might manifest later on, or kind of a speeding up of psychological evolution, as it were.
You really need to do those follow-up studies with these volunteers, don't you? Just get to keep a watch on them.
I do. Well, I've only been back in New Mexico about 18 months. I'm just getting my feet on the ground. So, and most of the volunteers still are living in the state, so it wouldn't be that hard to track down most all of them.
Yeah. So, we will continue our conversation with Rick Strassman. And again, his book, DMT, The Spirit Molecule, is available at the Radio Bookstore, 800-243-1438, or at radiobookstore.com. And when we continue, Rick, let's hear about the other kinds of beings that were encountered. After all, shamans and indigenous people have walked through these doorways into the alternate reality for many, many millennia, and I'm sure it's populated by much more than aliens and angels. So any of those, and also Robert Monroe, when he was doing his out-of-body research, felt that there were different shells around our Earth or our center here in the universe. And if you had changed the dose, do you think you would have ended up in different astral levels or whatever? Do you correlate that? So all of that and more with Rick Strassman coming up.
Maura Lee Online, www.mauralee.com.
We continue our conversation with Dr. Rick Strassman, his book, The DMT, The Spirit Molecule. But before you answer those two questions posed to you right before that break, I want to broaden the scope of it and ask, it would seem to me that the biochemicals are just one avenue or one marker of physiological change, perhaps we're also changed by energetics or consciousness, prayer, intent, body postures in the work of Elizabeth Gooden that I'm sure you're aware of, and sound therapy and color and fragrance and all of these things could then tend to stimulate the production of our own biochemicals in a certain way.
Right.
Also, if nature doesn't work alone in isolates, and I would think that the body would produce a whole gamut like you would find in the natural plant out there. There's a lot of synergistic compounds that go along with it.
Right.
So I would think that the body also, as nature would produce a whole gamut of these kind of chemicals, and that the DMT would be one element of a whole stew.
Well, that's true. Yeah, that probably is the case, and a number of other consciousness-altering compounds are produced in the brain. There's actually a chemical cousin of DMT, which is called 5-methoxy-DMT, which is quite hallucinogenic, and that's also made in the brain and the blood and the lung and the liver, and probably in the pineal gland as well, especially if DMT is. And there's bufotenine, which is in certain kinds of toads and is also in plants and also is produced in humans. So there is a stew, probably, of substances that the brain makes in order, to help us make these transitions.
And so the type of experience one would have would maybe be mediated by the combination of these chemicals as much as anything. Maybe the DMT alone tended towards the alien experience.
It could, and the more kind of visionary one, right. In the people I've talked with that have used this chemical cousin of DMT, this 5-methoxy-DMT, it isn't quite as visual.
Mm-hmm.
It seems to more produce experiences of the white light. It's more of a kind of death-like experience for a lot of people. So it may play a large part in those sort of experiences, to a larger extent than might be the case in the more kind of visionary ones that may be mediated through primarily DMT.
Also, a shaman would come and say, it really also has to do with the spirit of the plant. And so if you have a chemical that is synthesized, it would still be very similar to a chemical found in a plant, and the plant spirit might have the geophobe over that use of that. Whether it came from a plant or not, it would still be the molecule that would be recognized. Or, you might say something like that in terms of the devas that govern certain activities. I know that in looking at the literature of the ayahuasca use, and I even had a wonderful experience when someone just played the song that the ayahuasca shamans use.
You like the songs, aren't they?
Just the songs alone gave me the experience. I didn't need the plant.
Right.
That would be explained by, the spirit of the plant or the spirit of the shaman is carried along by those energetic waves.
I think so.
So, it's just a very whole interesting realm here with many different elements to it. And it's fascinating to look at one element, but then also to contemplate what it would look like with all of these other elements added, and which is what the spiritual practices are, and what happens when someone practices a certain meditation or a certain chanting or whatever. Could that be stimulating DMT and similar molecules in our own body, which is why we have those mystical experiences associated with those practices?
Well, I think so, sure. Any experience in the mind, obviously, has got a correlate in the brain. It might not be cause and effect. We could really spend a lot of time about the cause versus the effect sort of discussion, but
still. It's a chicken and egg question.
The chicken and egg.
Mm.
But I think it's unarguable that there are at least correlates of conscious experience in the brain. And if the changes in the brain occur first and the consciousness then follows thereafter, or if the effect on consciousness then kind of results in the release of these chemicals in sort of a cascading form is a hard question to answer. But there are clearly correlates, and probably some kind of biological underpinning, as it were.